We know that India has this very ambitious plan to become a global electronics hub. How are you planning on achieving this?
Thanks a lot for having me with you today. In the last 3 months, the response from almost all the global majors, chip makers, semiconductor design people is fabulous response. It's excellent response. Most of the president level, CEO level, functionaries of these companies have visited India, met all the senior people here, have started evaluating some locations, and tomorrow and day after, we are organizing a major semicon conference in Bangalore, in which about 10,000 people are participating, including the global major CEOs, presidents, professors from Berkeley and Stanford. So the response is really, really very heartening. And we think that we are on the right track.
In terms of being on the right track as well, we know that the Intel CEO has met with India's Prime Minister. Has there been kind of any clear communication about whether or not there is going to be chip plants from Intel in India or other big corporations really trying to help you get to this goal?
Yes, there is a clear commitment. There's a clear directional change which is happening. So many of these global majors were considering some other geographies. And today, based on the program that we have rolled out and based on the clear and sincere steps that we have taken, there is India is there, right there, squarely on their global plans, whether it is Intel, Global Foundry, TSMC is still taking more time, but other big ones are very, very serious in their plans.
And late last year, Minister, the government did announce a $10 billion incentives plan to woo some of these chip makers in India. Can you give us an update on what companies are likely to be the first to make silicon wafers in India?
So it wouldn't be proper for me to name the companies because most of the applications which are there are confidential applications. But I can say that the large memory makers, the large logic chip makers, all of them are very keen. Some of them have already made their applications and others are in the process of evaluating the locations, finalizing their partnerships, making their business plans clear because it is a big shift for most of them. The global majors were considering Europe or America or some geographies in Southeast Asia, but now they have shifted towards India. So that's where they have to recast their business plans. So it wouldn't be proper for me to take the names, but I can assure you that the majors are there.
Sure. You mentioned about TSMC. We see some of these big chip makers like Samsung, TSMC, they're making big investments in building plants in the U.S. TSMC recently also talking about building a $7 billion plant in Japan, Germany also on their radar. Why do you think India stands out as a chip-making hub? And how do you kind of beat this competition right now?
So that's a very good question. So, see, the two major factors that the global CEOs have told us are, first is India is a very stable democracy, very clear, absolutely clear political roadmap. It's a stable democracy. It's a talent nation. Today, close to 20% of the entire design talent in the world in the field of semiconductors is working out of India. So that makes a big difference. That makes a very big difference. Above all, in our semiconductor program, we have committed to develop 85,000 talent over the next 10 years. So a clear roadmap, a clear focus on talent, a clear focus and a clear and sincere attempt to assuage all the risks and some of the concerns that the industry has so far shared with us, we have worked very transparently and sincerely with them. So that's what is giving confidence to the industry.
Minister, let's move to one of your other portfolios, and that is of railways. And we've seen this coal shortage and the lack of transportation of coal on the railway rakes really lead to some power shortages in the scorching summer. What are you doing to try and rectify that?
So you're very right. So we undertook a massive CapEx program in railways. So last fiscal, which ended on 31st March, we completed the financial year with a capex of 25 billion US. And this year our capex will be 28 billion US. Lots and lots of investment is needed in creating more capacity, whether it is wagons, whether it is locomotives, whether it is tracks, signals, electrification, practically every part of the railway ecosystem. So for example, we are in the process of finalizing a tender for 100,000 wagons, which is a $5 billion tender. Then there is a tender for locomotives, which is $2.6 billion tender, which has just been floated. Another tender for train sets, $3 billion, signaling $1 billion. Almost another $10 billion worth tenders are in the pipeline. I can share with you that today India is practically the largest railway market, among the largest railway markets, because of this large capex push that we have undertaken. And this is going to help us in increasing the capacity, making sure that we shift more and more cargo from road to rail.
And what is the concern or risks of, I guess, the overemphasis of the use of coal?
Listen, we have made our position very clear during the COP conference, and our commitment is that we as a country will become net zero by 2070, and we are on the path. Coal is still a mainstay, but look at the giant strides we have made in renewable. So already the total installed base of renewable has crossed 100 gigawatts, which was 10 years back, it was just about 10 gigawatt or less than that. Today it has already crossed 100 gigawatt. Almost we are adding 7 to 8 gigawatt every year to this pipeline. So that's the kind of push we have to make. And given our position in the development cycle, we definitely need very low cost and affordable sources of power. So we have to have that right mix, and we have to have that right transition time.